talk to people like advertising and they punch you in the face. Who wants to work in that industry where consumers would like to punch you in your face for the content that you put out there? I don't. And I think that William Price yesterday, he showed a good video that actually predicted the end of the traditional advertising agency. I'm going to use that video and guarantee you that. When it comes to destination marketing, the word brand will come up over and over and over again. And when I was a tourist in British Columbia, you know, I came in sort of from a techie business perspective, and this word brand kept being thrown into my face, and I thought, well, brand must be something that's really, really complicated. So I started to research it, because, you know, every decision that I made or everything that I wanted to do was being shut down because of something related to the brand. And then I realized that branding is actually quite simple. A brand is actually something that is really personal. I was born in Amsterdam, so now you can start playing the accent game. And if I say Amsterdam to all of you, it will mean something different to every single one of you. Maybe some of you have been there, maybe some of you haven't. But the brand perception of a destination like Amsterdam is shaped by the stories that you've heard about Amsterdam. That could be stories in media, could be movies, could be advertising, could be the DMO, could be Tourism Holland, but also the stories that your friends have shared, the photos that you see on social media, and everything else. So not everything is treated equal anymore. And also the volume of social conversation is now outnumbering the traditional messages by a large number. So the stories that people are telling are actually more important. Now, how do people tell stories? How does story shape that people tell? And that's the second bullet here. It's through all the experiences that somebody has in a destination. You will go somewhere with a particular view of the destination, and then you have a whole number of experiences, and you'll leave with different perspectives. And that, then those perspectives turn into the stories that you will now share with others. And those stories are more and more happening in social media. And those in turn then turn into the brand perception that others have. And that's, we've seen a lot of conversation about that as well. I mean, Emmanuel was talking about it. So what we need to move from is from telling stories in advertising to telling authentic stories. And not just ourselves, making sure that people on the ground are telling authentic stories. Here's your typical DMO ad, in this case from Greece, and I don't know why, but every time there's a spa ad, there's a woman with rocks on her back. Is that actually comfortable? Is that actually something that is cool? I've never done it. I hope I never will. And on the other side here, you see Lindsay, the organizer of the conference. Thank you, Lindsay. Great job. And she was in Greece, and she shared a photo on Facebook. And you can see somebody replied, because now all of a sudden it's an authentic story, it's an authentic photo where somebody can think, hey, if Lindsay can have that experience, I can as well. I was in the Facebook session this morning, and you know, they showed a lot of research, and more research is being done of the impact that, you know, just one channel, an important one, Facebook has on the travel decision making. And some of these stats are really mind-blowing, including the number of people that will make a travel decision purely based on the photos that they will see from their friends on Facebook. And when I saw those numbers, 20%, 30%, 50%, depending on which research study you believe, I thought to myself, that's really, really high. And then I thought back to my own life. And a few years ago, we went on vacation to Chile. And I thought the only reason why we went to Chile is because my wife's friend went to Chile and shared a whole bunch of photos on Facebook, and then my wife said, that's where we're going. And then I'm in charge of research and planning and booking the trip and everything. So a lot of conversations in the last couple of days about advertising and how really what's more important is the stories that people are telling. So this is definitely the pattern. So if storytelling is what the future of destination marketing is, or the presence already, then the destination is really the stage where these stories are told. And who is the best at telling stories? That's Disney. So this is a map of Disneyland. And if you research how Disneyland makes every decision is through storytelling, that's how the original theme park was actually conceived. Disney looked at it as storyboards, like how he would make a movie. That's how he created the park. So everything in Disneyland has a story. There's an overall story for Disneyland. And then there's a story for each individual section, or if you want to compare it to a city, for each neighborhood, or if you want to compare it to a country, for each state. Every state has its own brand, or every part of the park has its own branding, its own theme, its own music, and it all fits, down to the last detail. Here's an example. This is Yolt's Christmas store in Frontierland, in Disneyland. And Frontierland is where they have rebuilt a pioneer city from the 1700s. And the building that you see there on the corner is actually, has its own story. A woodworker lives there with his family, and he immigrated from Germany. And his wife is taking care of the kids, and he's doing his craft at home. So when you walk into that store, you will see artifacts like his tools, you'll see toys for the children, you'll see what his wife uses to support her family. And by creating stories for everything in the Disney theme parks, when you walk through it, you get this feeling that everything just fits. And that's because the story is really thought through. And as an actor in the story, if you walk into this stage, you will actually experience the stories that Disney wants you to have, and therefore the stories that Disney wants you to tell. And Jen really tweeted it out well, which was retweeted here by Adam, that really sort of supports this notion. Does everybody here know who this guy is? Spock. How many of you here are Trekkies? This is sort of a research project that I do around the world. It's about 2%. When I ask this question in North America, it's about 90%. And when I do it in Europe, people are afraid to put their hands on it. So this is Spock. And what planet is he from? Vulcan. Thank you. So there's a community in Alberta, Canada, and it's called Vulcan. And it's a small town. It's really in the middle of nowhere. It's nowhere near any big city. It's not near a highway. It's a farming town. There's a big John Deere dealership, a little main street, and that's about it. So not really your hot tourism destination. But their name is Vulcan. So what did they do? They ran with it. They ran with Star Trek. So first, they put a copy of the Star Trek Enterprise next to the highway. And next thing you know, all Trekkies were stopping and getting the pictures taken. Then they turned the visitor center into a spaceship. And over the years, that spaceship has turned into a Star Trek museum, where there's all kinds of movie memorabilia. All the actors have visited. They've all left props from the movie. And once a year now, they organize Galaxy Fest, where all the Star Trek geeks descend on the town, and for a whole weekend, they sort of, you know, celebrate their Star Trek geekdom. Visitors to this tiny little community have grown from a few thousand to 30,000 in just a few years. And that might not be much for a bigger destination, but for a small town like Vulcan, that's huge. And now you can imagine all these farmers, they're all, you know, observing this. What's going on, right? But slowly but surely, the whole destination has embraced this to a point where City Hall has now been renamed Galaxy Headquarters. So this is a way of storytelling and really embracing it to the ultimate level. So when storytelling and the stories that consumers are sharing in social media is really what the marketing is, should we be marketers at all? Or should we really be managing the destination, just like Disney is managing the destination, managing the destination, and then in turn managing the marketing. So I asked this question 4 years ago, and I think it was answered today by Emmanuel, who said, well, we're actually going from destination marketing to destination management. And it was great to be part of her journey for the last few years. So if managing the storytelling happens on the ground, not every story is going to be awesome. So you need to manage what we call your feedback loops. So if this is, you know, sort of your traditional marketing funnel that people move through, you can pick the one that you like. But the point is, really, when somebody visits and sort of evaluates, often in real time, what the experience is like, they can do two things. They can say, well, I don't like it, or I love it. If they don't like it, well, they won't come back. And they'll probably tell people that they shouldn't come. But if they like it, they might come back, and of course, they tell others. And that's how you can get feedback loops that really accelerate the growth of your business or your destination. And on the negative side, you need to mitigate the negativity, just like Jesse said this morning in his presentation. Even some of them can be really small, some of them can be very large. But you need to have a plan for that. And that's why you need to work with your industry. It has come up a few times as well. So that, for example, they manage their TripAdvisor ratings and their TripAdvisor reviews properly. It's more fun to talk about positive feedback loops. So I'll give you an example of the power of a positive feedback loop. So this here is Chef Roy Choi. And Roy was a cook in LA. And he worked at a big restaurant, and one day he had an idea. He's in LA, there's a lot of Mexican influence there, Southern California. His roots are from Korea. So he created a new product, and they are, it's Korean barbecue tacos. And apparently they're delicious. So he started with a really, really good product. And then he thought, okay, I'm going to jump on board with this new trend of food trucks. So I'm going to sell these tacos out of a food truck. Well, so far, it was pretty normal. You know, good product in a food truck, okay. The problem was, he didn't really have the proper licensing to park in heavy traffic areas. He couldn't go to big malls, or he couldn't go to big business centers during lunch and park his truck so that people could come buy his product. He always had to be a few blocks away. And there was a real challenge. So the solution that he came up with was, okay, well, I'll just use Twitter. I'll tell Twitter where I'm going to be. And what happens when you do something like that, and you know, you're talking to geeks like myself, it becomes a game. And that's like catnip. You know, now all of a sudden it becomes a game to find the food truck. And what happens when you find the food truck? People will tweet it, people will put it on Facebook, people will take pictures just to brag about it, right? I found the food truck, I found Koji. There's actually a guy here, and he took a picture of himself in front of the food truck. It's like he's standing in front of the Eiffel Tower. This is proof, right? Taking a picture of yourself in front of a tourism product is like proof that I've been there. If you own that product, or if you're the destination that product is located in, you know that you have something that people will share in social media to take a picture of themselves in front of it. So that's how remarkable this Koji food truck became in LA. And because of all this conversation, the feedback loops just keep fueling the hopper to a point that by the time the food truck showed up, it would be a 3-hour wait. 3 hours to buy a taco from a food truck. That's the power of a positive feedback loop. And that can work for a product, it can work for a destination. Oh yeah, by the way, I found a food truck as well. I had to drive an hour. I was in LA and I was like, now I've been talking about this food truck for like a year and a half, and I'm not going to find the thing too. So I did. And I didn't have to wait 3 hours, but it was definitely, probably half an hour, 45 minute wait. And it was just in a residential neighborhood. It was hilarious. It was just, you know, it was just houses that people are all sitting in the grass. It was like, you know, its own little community. So we have four food trucks now, and Tourism California is actually actively using them in their advertising. So we dove in a little deeper, you know. I thought, okay, if this food truck is so popular, you know, he must be getting rave reviews on Yelp. And Yelp is the community where people rate restaurants. I don't know if it's the same in Australia, but you probably have the equivalent. So, but he only had 3.5 stars. I thought, how is that possible? You know, everybody just goes to this truck, they wait for hours. You know, how come he only has 3.5 stars? So I read, this is what I do in my spare time, I read hundreds of reviews to figure this out. So it kind of boiled down to this. If it's 5 stars, people are generally really, really excited about the food truck. Nothing like these tacos, the searching for the truck is half the fun, you know, the homemade sauce is made with taste for but an orgasm. I don't think you can get any better than that. So when you get to 4 stars, you know, I had to wait for half an hour, I went to some friends, definitely delicious, worth the wait. You can sort of see the weight creeping in a little bit. 3 stars, good food, but I don't want to wait for it. 2 stars, Korean barbecue amazing, tacos amazing, I don't like the combo. It happens, they don't like the product. And then 1 star, I don't like the food, I don't like the weight, I don't see what the big deal is. So, from this little bit of research that I did, you know, I created this chart here. Called the MET chart. Right up that dimension. There's always a bunch of people that are going to love your product, love a particular experience. At the same time, there's probably also going to be people that hate it. What you need to do is focus on the people that love you, and they will market to the people in the middle that kind of go, that's yeah, I'll go there, it's good. I'm not going to rave about it. The more people you can turn into lovers, the more advocates you have, the more marketers you have, just like Jesse on his social media team, and the more you ignore the people that are most likely going to hate you, the less they will complain about you in social media. And when I talk to hotels, I share this story. Because what hotels tend to do in the off-season is they drop their rates, and all of a sudden a hotel that's really tailored to a business traveler, that's maybe $250 a night, all of a sudden it's $80. They get a family coming in, but they still have to pay $25 for Wi-Fi. They still have to, when they go for breakfast, they still have to pay a large amount for that. They have to pay for parking. What happens as a result? That complaint on TripAdvisor, the hotel drops the position on TripAdvisor, and there's actually research conducted that shows the correlation between where you rate on TripAdvisor and the profitability of particular businesses. So you really need to consider, do I really go for the short-term gain because it might have long-term implications? And I had a really good conversation about this with the revenue manager at the Novotel that we're staying at here. And what they do in those cases is actually try to make these people that come in at a lower rate extra special by sort of tailoring the experience to them, which I think is a smart thing to do. So you have lovers and you have haters. And when you think about the storytelling in your destination that people are doing, you should really consider the end-to-end experience of your destination. And you can map that out. So from the time people arrive at the airport or train station or by car, you can sort of see every touch point that they have in your destination, because it's essentially a touch point with your destination brand. How do they feel about it? You know, we were working with one destination once, and it turns out that everybody hated the experience of jumping into a cab. And they actually complained about it in social media. So that could be a hated experience, which in turn will turn into a negative story in social media. Other experiences are worth raving about, rating a food experience or taking a picture in front of the Sydney Opera House. if you understand this, and if you understand what people like, what people not like, and detect the patterns, you can mitigate the negative and you can amplify what people find remarkable. And this is actually a discipline emerging, and it's called service design. Service design is really looking at all facets of the destination and starting to basically using tools and principles of interaction design that we developed 10, 15 years ago when we were building websites, and using those same tools and same principles and applying it to the offline world, paper prototyping, usability testing, researching. There's actually a research tool that you can use where you get your guests to download it onto their iPhone or iPad, and as they go to the destination, they can take photos and they can rate everything that they do, and then you can, you know, correlate all these experiences, put them on a map, and look at it over time, and really start to find the patterns and finding the things that people will complain about and the opportunities that you have for better storytelling. Something as simple as if somebody really likes one particular thing or a bunch of people over and over again, they just won't share it because, for example, there's no Wi-Fi, you can add a Wi-Fi hotspot there so that people have the opportunity right away to take that picture and share it and therefore amplify the storytelling. So there's a great book called This is Service Design Thinking, if you're interested. 3 years from now, this conference, there's going to be sessions. So the remarkable experience is that's actually the stuff that people will share in social media. So what makes something remarkable, by our definition, is when some people actually grab their phone and take a picture because they want to share it, or take a video because they want to share it. Now, I'm a big Formula One fan. So a few years ago, Tourism Valencia contacted me. They host the F1 race, and they said, William, we have a business proposition for you. We want you to come to Valencia and give a presentation to our industry, and in return we will put you on a blog trip to the F1 race. I'm like, done, I'm in. So I told Rodney and Ben, and I said, listen guys, I'm going to Valencia, they invited me to go to a presentation there. They said, oh great, how much are we getting paid? Nothing! So I went there, and I actually got to stand 5 meters from the start of a Formula One race. And for somebody that is really into Formula One, that is like the ultimate experience to stand right there, the noise and the action and the adrenaline. So I took a video of it, posted it on YouTube, and in 2 years it got 40,000 views because there's plenty of other nuts like me who like watching this stuff. And, you know, and once in a while I have to start moderating all the comments that are coming in because, you know, people are telling me, you know, what a cool video it is. And how, you know, like a video like that is actually better than watching it on TV. And I think part of that is because, you know, I do a little intro, film myself, and then at the end I'm like, whoa, that's so cool. And I think that adds a lot of authenticity, just like, you know, the video that Emmanuel just shared. I had a really, really remarkable experience the other day. Tourism Wollongong threw me out of a plane. And of course, I put that stuff on Facebook. And you can see there's somewhat like 43 likes and, you know, probably about a dozen comments. And this is the stuff that as a DMO you don't see, but if you do your job right, this is happening. And instead of having a million people on your Facebook page, you can have a million people just sharing your photo in their own personal networks. And if you read a book by Paul Adams called The Group, you'll find out why that is actually way more important than anything else. Making sure that you get people talking, even if you don't see it. And what really impressed me was how the Skydive by the Beach team has streamlined this process with GoPros that the instructor has in his hands. He's making a video. He's two GoPros, one for video, one for photos. The next day, you get your photos printed off, you get a DVD, you can go online to access all these photos, you can share those photos from the online application straight onto your fan page, tagged and everything. So really, this is a perfect example of how you take a remarkable experience and maximizing the storytelling as a result of it. Really impressed. I'm going to use this one in presentations. So if you get people talking, they will do the marketing for you. That's really what the synopsis is of all this. So I told you I'm a big Formula One fan, and Emmanuel talked about niche marketing, and niche marketing is something that we really, really advocate, because traditional marketing is sort of looking at the destination as a whole, finding the things that sort of differentiate you for a particular market, and then ignoring everything else and just keep repeating that story. We actually think that you should go bottom up. You should think about, okay, what kind of remarkable experiences do I have? What niche audiences does this speak to so that they will share this in social media, and how do I activate it? So if you look at the Formula One community, you know, there's forums that, you know, I go after every race. I go into the forum and I talk to the other F1 geeks, and we talk about, you know, who should be suspended because they caused a crash, and, you know, what were the pit stop times. But there's also the F1 teams, they have their own blogs, there's the drivers with blogs, and then there's media and people that are just in the know that talk about this thing, about this stuff. And as an F1 fan, you read all this, and if you're not an F1 fan, you think, well, yeah, waste of time. And I'm pretty sure you have something similar. So passionate communities form online around a common passion. Whether it is skydiving, whether it is F1, or whether that's golfing, or whether that is, you know, whatever it is. So the passion sits in the middle. Around it are a group of influencers. And influencers are just people that have either more reach, or they are in the know, or they just have access to certain information that the rest of the community doesn't. And that's why everybody follows them. So their influence is more as a result. And then you have the community around it, just like in F1, you know, I'm part of a community, I read all the stuff on the influencers, I talk to other people within the community. And then outside of that is everybody else, because there's often spillover, just like now, I've been talking about F1 for about 3 minutes, and, you know, maybe one of you is going to go, oh, I should check that out one day. We're a passionate community too, right in this room. And not only in this room, because there's also a passionate community member in South Africa who was following along on the Twitter account at 2:30 in the morning last night. You know, if that's not passionate, then I don't know what is. So how do we apply this principle? I'll give you a few examples. There's a group of ski resorts in British Columbia in Canada called themselves the Powder Highway. Whistler, where the Olympics was, that's really the big resort, but it actually turns out that these smaller resorts have deep powder and really, really good skiing conditions for the hardcore skiers. So we created a campaign that was really targeting the hardcore skiers. We created the Ultimate Ski Bump campaign. Because what is the ultimate remarkable experience for a ski bump? To do nothing else all season but ski. So that's the prize we put together. Free lift tickets, accommodation, gas money, a car, money for food, and you can just ski all winter. And people have to submit their video to explain why they should win this prize. One person went so far, his video was him going to a tattoo shop and tattooing ski bum on his hands. That's how passionate this guy was about winning this prize. And he didn't win. But ski bump stands for, it's more of an overarching term in North America, so I'm sure he doesn't mind. We worked with Montreal last year, and we went through a different group of influencers. We went through, in the music niche, we went through the bands, because bands have a large influence over their fans. So we created a battle of the bands through Facebook, where bands would have to battle each other by getting their fans to vote, and in the final rounds they actually had to do a cover of Corey Hart's Sunglasses at Night, the 80s classic. So we have 8 amazing cover videos that they put together in just a week and a half, and then they went just at like SoMeT, at the SoMeT event, like when we picked the host destination, they went head to head. Tons of voting, tons of conversation about Montreal as a result, and when you get a lot of conversation on social media, it often spills over in traditional media who jumped on board as well. And the final example is a small town in Richmond, British Columbia, Richmond, BC is just under Vancouver. It's the airport town. Most people fly in and then drive straight to Vancouver. But they actually have one thing that really differentiates them, which is Asian foods. They have a large Asian population. So they have about 400 really top quality Asian restaurants. But nobody knows about this. So we put a contest together where we were putting a search out, just like your best job in the world here, also an inspiration borrowed from that, where we would create a job for a food blogger for a whole year. But the twist was that this person would have to go to a restaurant and blog about it every single day for a whole year. No weekends, no vacation, no taking time off for Christmas. Every day, eat and blog. She also got a gym membership, by the way. So as soon as we launched this campaign, it caused mayhem in the food blogger community, because finally, here was an opportunity for most of these people who are not getting paid to turn their passion into a real job. So the mayhem it caused in social media spilled over into traditional media as well. It was all the TV stations and what have you. Here's the winner, Lindsay. She got the job. She actually just finished it a few weeks ago. So what happened in this campaign was that we used the food bloggers to reach the community of foodies, the community that is actually crazy enough to read those blogs, and that community in turn would reach everybody else. And you could probably see this in your own network if you're not a foodie. I'm not a foodie, but I have a couple of foodies in my office. So every time our anniversary comes around, I go to Robin in her office and I said, hey, what's the good restaurant in Vancouver? And she'd go, oh, you should go here and here and here. Because she does read all the food blogs. She's a foodie. So by activating food bloggers, we make all the foodies aware, who in turn will make all their friends aware about dining in Richmond. So every destination has storytellers, and you know this has come up a few times over the last few days. You have different groups of stakeholders that can help you get the story out, from your staff to your local residents, to visitors that have been here, your industry, and the influences that I just talked about. And we saw it in the Queensland presentation when they were talking about videos. We saw the example of the San Diego Zoo. And we heard it over and over again on Twitter, how you can work with these groups of stakeholders to get the story out. Now this is my favorite travel blogger. Her name is Mari. She's 2 years old, and she's my daughter. And she's with us, and she went on her first FAMIL the other day, here in Wollongong, where they took her to, I forgot the name, she hugged a koala and she had a kangaroo. So check out her blog, travelingwithparents.com. Now, yesterday at the blog panel, there was a lot of conversation about should we pay bloggers to come on a blog trip or not. And I actually don't agree that we should, because you don't pay travel writers to come visit your destination either. And then people came up to me after and they kept asking, what did you think of that? What did you think of that? But I didn't realize, because it was such a big firestorm on Twitter that, you know, nobody actually sort of challenged me in the room. And I had bloggers and DMOs jumping all over me on Twitter yesterday after saying that. I think there are times when you can pay bloggers, like when they are doing a specific project for you, like when they, for example, maybe do a photo shoot for you and you get to keep the photos, or you do something else, it's a longer period of time, there's a per diem. There are exceptions, but I don't think a typical blog trip should be compensated. So to conclude this part, how do you measure the destination experience? And what we advocate is NPS. When we sort of talk about this whole thing about managing your destination experience, getting the stories told, you know, what's the best way of measuring that? Measuring the effectiveness of a DMO is really, really hard, because you know there's so many external factors that you can't control, the economy and what have you. So what we actually advocate is to use NPS, which stands for Net Promoter Score. And what it does, it's, you know, a lot of Fortune 500 companies use this. You ask one simple question: would you recommend this destination to a friend? The people who rated 9 or 10, those are most likely to recommend it to their friends. The people rated 0 to 6, they're most likely to not recommend it. You subtract the detractors from the promoters, and there's your score. And there's a lot of correlation between higher NPS scores and lower NPS scores. So if you use this as a unifying measure for your whole destination, all of a sudden people will start moving into the right path by offering better experiences, by mitigating the negative experiences, and it's really a way to rally your whole industry together. So, starting to run out of time, so really quickly, I'll show you what we're doing at Think to help our clients. First of all, we put social at the core of marketing. And I think, you know, that story's well told over the last few days. Instead of starting with traditional and then saying, okay, how can we use social to extend this? How can we use our fan page or our Twitter account to get this campaign out to the masses? We say, no, let's start with something that's social, that people will share, and then use digital media or traditional media to extend it where it makes sense. Just like Emmanuel used her little picture frames to get the campaign a unified look. That makes sense. And when you see some of the comments on Twitter, you can see that this is sort of an idea that has become more and more commonplace. So what we do is we categorize our clients in 5 levels. Before we had this, there's a different range of where people are at, and it's okay. It's okay if you're at 2, it's okay if you're at 3 or 4. But what happened was we would sort of try to get people from one place to another way too quick, and we ran into problems. So, you know, we researched this and we created 5 levels, and it's not that dissimilar from what Kate was talking about yesterday, when she said from a social consumer to a social brand to a social business. So for us, it's if you're level 1, you're just ignoring it completely. Level 2, somebody has started something, but management and leadership is really not paying attention. Level 3, social is really used to, you know, support traditional. At level 4 is when somebody is starting to really take social serious by having a strategy to move forward with real KPIs, with real objectives, with dedicated budgets, dedicated teams, dedicated agencies. When you get to level 4, something funny happens, and Rodney tweeted this. If you get to level 4, you realize that your whole business has changed. And that's what Emmanuel was talking about. And that's the journey that Emmanuel's really, really far at. And that's why it's so good to have her here, so she can share that. So, I was talking to Rodney the other day, and I said, you know, it's really not rocket science, it's just a paradigm shift. And he said, put that in. So here it is. So really what you need is a strategy to get yourself up the ladder, up the levels of social media sophistication. Now, the word strategy has also been thrown around in different ways. We responded to an RFP a few months ago, and somebody in the RFP said, we want a strategy. So we gave them a whole process, this is what we're going to do, look at your remarkable experiences, your communities, and niche fashion communities. At the end, all they wanted was a marketing campaign. They just called that their strategy. So what is a strategy? A strategy is really sort of a long-term direction that you're taking your organization down with a goal, what you want to achieve. It's like you're going on a car trip. You know that you're going from, I don't know, Sydney to Melbourne. A strategy is your roadmap. Okay, we're going to stop here, we're going to sleep there, we're going to, you know, check out this viewpoint there, and we're going to take a little scenic bypass here. That's our plan. And the tactic is really stepping in the car and going left and right and stopping for a traffic light and keep going. If you wouldn't have your roadmap, you would just move in all directions and you probably never reach your finish line. So that's what you need. What is the purpose of my Facebook page? And I hear everybody thinking, and we've talked about this, there's so many obstacles. Destination marketing, destination management. It is a different gig. It's a tough gig. You know, we're dealing with a political environment, we have stakeholders that might not get it, we actually don't own the product ourselves, I have an organization and team members, you know, they really don't want change. They just like the way things are. How do you move this forward? So you can build a strategy, but really what we're talking about is an organizational culture. And an organizational culture needs to support what you're trying to do. So how do you get this culture changed? So we look at this as a scale, and these are just a few examples, not a definite list. So right now, most organizations, you know, most things the organization does supports a traditional culture. So the scale is tips towards traditional. So the first thing we do, and what you should do in your own internal organization, is we look at a long list, again, this is just a few examples, and then we put them on a 1 to 5 scale. It's like, okay, where are they for different departments, for different activities, KPIs, the way they handle their stakeholders, the way they collaborate with their industry, the way they work with influencers, are they still just treating bloggers like another travel writer, putting them on traditional press trips, or do they customize the trip, do they build in free time, do they make sure there's Wi-Fi available all the time, so it's quite detailed. And then we have this whole map, and then we create a strategy where we move all these blocks forward based on priority, based on where's the low-hanging fruit, and where can we get some quick wins. And the more of these blocks we move over, what you see is then at one point the scale tips. And some of the biggest obstacles cannot stop the momentum anymore that you have built. And then you're really on the path to becoming a social business. Now, who's responsible for this? You know, I had a different slide, but I thought, you know what, I'll put Jesse in here. He said it best, you know. You need to lead the organization. It's really our job here. The people in this room are responsible. Maybe you have people that are higher up into the org chart, but it's really your job to be an evangelist, it's your job to be an advocate, and it's really your job to move things forward, just like Jesse did, just like Emmanuel did, just like others did. And I couldn't have said it better myself than what Becky said just a few hours ago. Be brave, take risks, don't be afraid to fail. If you fail, fail forward. Thank you very much. I'm with Think, and these are the people from Think that are in the room here. If you haven't said hi to all of us, please do. Thank you very much for attending this conference.